Yeah, I can see. Can you hear me? I can
and this
see.
Is yeah. Mr. Autobus himself.
For those who don't know, Chips Yap, he's a highly respected senior motoring journalist in the country. He joined. Yeah, highly respected.
I grew up reading about his work.
Yeah.
Autocar.
Yeah, we all do. Chips joined the motoring journalism since the late 1970s. He specified not late 1970s, it's late 1970s. So he's the right person for the topic today, which is how the industry, the automotive industry have shifted in the past 40 years. Together with our second guest, Hans Chong, among ourselves, we actually call him the Chips Yap of our generation. So we will look into how the industry will shift in the next 40 years, right? Before and after. So let's rewind, go back to 1977, and how was the scene like? Uncle Chips. He doesn't like me calling him.
Well, actually, when I bought my first car, it was a second-hand car. And in those days, I think used car dealers were less organized than now. So it was not difficult to buy a used car. And of course, cars were cheaper then. I can remember from those days is that car showrooms were very simple. They were not air-conditioned. And the salesman... Actually, I think that I was almost in the same era as when my father was buying cars. You know, it didn't change that much. You wanted to buy a car, you went to the showroom and you talked a bit with the salesman. And then you got your car. And
do you get to test drive the car?
No. Test drives were actually quite rare. Until, in Malaysia, until about, say, the late 1990s. Oh. In fact, you know, even when Proton came out, you would imagine that Proton test drives would be available, but for some reason, you know, it was difficult to get test drives because back then companies were not really prepared to spend money on test drive cars.
So car buyers, they're actually willing to buy the car even without trying them?
You have no choice, I guess.
A lot, yeah, they have no choice. A lot did not test it, you know. And even for us in our line of work, until about early 1990s, we had to take cars that were not registered for testing. We used what they call trade plates. We never had registered cars until the early 1990s. And you can imagine that was a little bit of a problem sometimes, right?
So what was the most popular car at that time when you were buying cars?
By the time I was buying cars, the Japanese had already taken over the market. So it was Datsun. Remember Datsun?
Yeah.
Nissan today and Toyota. They were always the two top guys, top brands fighting with each other. And I remember that the best European brand then, best selling European brand was Volvo. And Peugeot was also very close. Those two brands were right at the top. And the older people will remember the Peugeot 504 was legendary. Volvo was Volvo 240. Volvo was the premium brand of its time.
And at that time, they already have the plant in Shalom, right?
Yeah, they were the first.
They were the first. Volvo was the first to assemble cars in Malaysia. The landscape of the industry has changed simply in terms of how they treat customers. Last time, it was just, you want my car, you buy lah. You know? But today, they actually have to work harder because of competition. They have to really love the customer. So customer care is actually a big thing today, much more than when I started buying cars.
So how did it shift, like from the late 70s to 80s, then 90s? Like the features and safety features?
I think the time when... Oh, you're talking about features.
Yeah. And also features, the landscape, the whole industry.
No, let's talk about customer care. I think that up to about the late 80s, the term customer care in the Malaysian industry didn't exist. They treat customers well, but to actually dedicate themselves and to come out with money to look after customers, to make customers feel good, to win customers, that did not exist until 1988. I remember that year because Toyota, UMW Toyota was the first. I heard about it from some people. They had a big event at Shangri-La Hotel where they called the whole company and they introduced this thing called Toyota Total Care, TTC. With that, they started a division. dedicated to customer care. Today, it's a customer relations.
This issue. Was the late Eric Chia's day, is it?
Yes. When Dr. Eric Chia, Tan Sri Eric Chia was alive. And they started, they were the first company I remember in Malaysia to actually have a division dedicated to customer care.
Toyota?
Yes, and they had a call center and things like that. I was really impressed. And then after that, everyone else in the industry began to go along the same road because when one guy does it, the rest will do it. So, of course, the standards of customer care increased and good for the customers.
And they weren't as big back then as today, right? They weren't number one back then, right?
They were not number one because by then, Proton had come out. But they still spend the money. They were willing to spend the money. Mm-hmm. And the second thing, of course, was the showrooms changed. Again, I think Toyota also took the lead by air conditioning the showrooms. Before we never had air conditioned showrooms, you know, everything is natural air.
But back then, climate change wasn't a word yet. Maybe it was not as warm back then.
So even in cars as well, cars at that time didn't come with air cons.
Oh, by then they did. Nowadays, our air conditioner is all inside the dashboard, right?
Yeah.
What we call integrated.
Yeah.
But before 1980, it was hung from the dashboard.
I remember those.
You go to the aircon shop, you tell them you want an aircon. It was not standard in cars, you know. Some companies didn't even sell it.
I remember the fan, the
oh, that one is small fan. Volkswagen and Mini, they put one fan there and blow at you.
Yeah.
But you go to the aircon shop, they'll put what is called a hanging unit, and then they attach it to the bottom of the dashboard. Terrible, I know that one. And then in those days, the compressors were very inefficient, heavy, so you lose power if you put aircon. So a lot of people didn't want to put. But I remember that in 1980, that was the first time that we had an integrated aircon, and it was in a Honda Civic. The company was Sunden.
Okay.
And I attended that event. They introduced it and everything was really perfect. You know, you switch on the aircon, the compressor will just go click. Whereas in my car, which was an older one, I had air conditioner. You switch on the aircon, the whole car shakes. Because the compressor load is so great. It was a huge compressor. But this one was, everything was integrated. I believe Honda also was involved in the engineering of it. And that too started the industry towards integrated installation of aircons. But it wasn't until about maybe late 80s that it became something like a standard feature. And today, you know, every car comes with an aircon. The first Proton Saga, aircon was optional.
Really?
Yeah.
My dad had the first Proton Saga. Okay, I didn't know that he took the option.
That means he took the option.
But how does the dashboard look
How does the dashboard look like? Without, oh, there's
no,
a
the
vent,
but, there, but there's no aircon inside.
So it's a dummy switch.
So you only get blower.
So you get the wind from
hot air.
Okay.
So it was an option. And I think aircons in those days were maybe about 1-2,000.
Which was a lot of money back then.
So a lot of people want to save money, then they don't install the aircon.
1-2,000 for in a period of time when cars were less than 20,000, 15,000,
20,000. The first Proton was about 17,000, 18,000.
Yeah, my dad bought them.
And then there were also other accessories, which I didn't have at the start. Like what you all enjoy today, power window, central locking, which I think in every car has it, right?
Yeah.
Back then, that was a luxury. Safety features, I think.
Automatic transmission.
Automatic transmission.
Proton Saga first. Oh, Honda.
The Proton Saga 1.5i.
Istimewa.
That introduced automatic transmissions to Malaysians. Of course, we had automatic transmissions before.
Honda Matic
and all. But in the late 80s, that was about the time the 1.5i Saga came out. And that really introduced Malaysians to the convenience of automatic transmissions. And after that, it became accepted and people... And around that time also, I think the Toyota Corolla also had an automatic transmission that was more efficient. It was more accepted. Okay. But before that, the automatic transmission was viewed as... if you buy one, you lose performance and all.
High fuel consumption.
And when we used to get test car with automatic transmission, we'll scold the car company. Like, why you give me such a boring car? You know, today is a different thing. Now we get manual transmission. It's cool. Why you give me manual transmission? Of course, you young fellas, you want manual transmission.
No, not necessary.
Depends on what car.
Depends on what car.
Then you say how it has changed. less manual transmission car.
So Saga was the first car with automatic transmission at the
time? It wasn't the first car, but it was the first mass.
It introduced people
it
to
introduced
it.
People.
Okay, okay.
And power steering also, I think the 1.5 is the member also introduced the Rakyat to power steering, right?
Yeah. Power steering was around, but in the old days, we all need a bit of muscle, you know, to drive the car. We had no power steering, especially the European cars.
I also remember at that time, around the 80s, side mirrors, they are not compulsory. They are not a compulsory accessory for the car. And also, third brake light.
Yeah. Third brake light is around like, 90s, sometime right? in the 90s, 92.
92 or 93. Mm. That was much later. Mm. What about you? What do you remember, Hans? When did you start buying your first car?
Quite late, actually. I only bought my first car in 2013. Previously, I mean, I have been a very thrifty person, so I've only drive hand-me-down cars. So whatever my family doesn't want to use.
What was your first car?
The first car that I drove was actually the first generation Proton Saga. I still remember, 8 valve engine, no synchro mesh first gear, without power steering and all that. Yeah, so that was my it didn't have a left side mirror. So there's side mirror on the driver's side, but not on the passenger side. So that was. Yeah, I remember. But being someone who loves cars from a very young age, I have been observing cars for a very long time. And even though I wasn't in the industry back then, even within my lifetime, I could see how much the industry have changed. And from there, you can expect how fast the industry is going to change much later. And today, the default company car, a business car, is a Toyota Camry or Honda Accord. But I remember that when I was growing up, every middle-level manager that I know was driving a Ford Telstar. And Camry wasn't even a household name back then. There was a Toyota Corona, but it was not viewed as a very corporate car because Toyota is not a very corporate-ish, a brand that a business person would use. So it was a Ford Telstar. And I was also old enough to remember that Chips mentioned, Volvo was a very reputable brand back then. Today, we see when you mention luxury car, you always think BMW, Mercedes. But there was a period of time where all the professionals and all the people that your parents told you when you grow up, study hard boy, be like uncle like that.
And buy a Volvo.
And these people will always drive, most of the time, they always drive a Volvo. The business fellows will always drive a Mercedes, but the doctors and the lawyers and the accountants will most likely be in a Volvo 240. So it's a car that respectable people in society drive. But you look at that today, Volvo has lost a bit of that. That's another story altogether. But right now, with the new generation of cars, it's good to see them coming back. But what I'm trying to say is that the industry has always been in a flux. We often forget that the status quo that we see right now, we always assume that it will stay the same, but it hasn't always been that way. And it will, maybe in the next 20 years, things will also change very quickly. Chips mentioned, when he first started in this line, Japanese brands have pushed up the European brands. But right now, we have people starting talking about Chinese brands. You have the Geely's coming in and all that. So the reputation is a bit iffy. But you have to remember that the Japanese brand are in a position, in the same position that 40 years ago, the Morris and the Austins were at. That's what makes this industry very interesting. Things are always in
flux.
When Japanese
cars were first introduced, I remember it's Milo tin story that they were made. Because they were so fragile. Because I think the Japanese went for lightness.
Yeah.
So this Milo tin story actually
is
like an urban legend, you know.
It's a Datsun, I remember.
Yeah, it's a Datsun, but you know, it wasn't. People say it was made of Milo tin, but it's not true. And when I talk to some people, old timers, they tell me that actually the true story was that when you repair a car, maybe they welded on a metal sheet from a Milo can to repair a car. They welded on that sheet and then they paint over it. And then maybe one day somebody scraped it off.
And then
he sees the word Milo there and they're made of Milo, you know.
What?
And that's how the legend started.
Was it a common practice that they actually take a Milo can?
Well, they probably took patch. In those days, you know, we don't have such strict standards of repair.
So under the cherry tree stuff.
Yeah, you go to the welding shop and then the Fleur, if you got a hole in your bodywork, you'll just find a metal sheet, weld it back and paint over. No, it's not like today where they use laser machines and all to make sure your bodywork is straight. They've got painting booth, painting oven to make sure the paint is properly applied and all. In those days, it was... That's why the industry has advanced so much today. And with it comes a cost. You want good quality repair work, you also have to pay, you know?
So throughout these four decades, right, what do you see that is actually molding or steering the direction of the entire industry? Like, is it technology? That's for sure, right? Technology, customers, I mean, buyers, do they really like have an effect on what these car companies are doing along the way?
I think customers, to some extent, influence the car companies in what they give. And good car companies will obviously produce products that customers want because they understand their customers. The companies that simply produce products without understanding what their customers want or what the market wants won't go far. So, but again, it varies from market to market. Malaysia is a very challenging market because pricing is such a sensitive issue. The car companies would like to give more features. They have a lot of advanced safety features that you can see in other markets, but they cannot put it here just yet because it adds too much to the cost. So they have to wait until the cost of that system comes down further before they can include. That's why, you know, like ESC, stability control. Now we can see it in Honda City and Toyota
Even
Vios,
Protons.
And even Proton. But it's, that came out 20 years ago. So they've had to wait for the price to drop until it is possible for them to include it without bumping up the cost so much, or because they can absorb the cost and not change the price. Because even the slightest change in price, especially in the lower segment, can affect sales a lot. 100 bucks, 200 ringgit, you know, it can change the appeal of your car to the consumer.
Yeah.
But if you say what has changed, I think today's motorists, the greatest benefit to them is safety. They are in cars that are much safer than, you know, ever before.
And customers are definitely becoming more and more demanding on features and...
Well, that's a natural thing, you know. They want value for their money. Right?
So throughout all these years, 40 years, what's the next 40 year then? What do you expect to see in the next 40 years?
You have to ask him. He's the future generation.
Industry going to be like?
There's been a lot of change in terms of the status quo. So, I didn't live through the 70s period, but I've read enough about heritage and history to know that a lot of the impressions, the stereotypes of brands that we have today are not exactly true. They are the result of very good PR effort. Like now, you talk about driving pleasure, you always associate BMW. But in the 70s, BMW wasn't even a household name. And Alfa Romeo was a default driver's car. So, what happened? Where's Alfa Romeo today? And where's BMW today? And if you look back, look towards the future, how will the status quo change? And more importantly, is even this whole thing about driving pleasure, emotional driving, is that even going to be a motivating factor now? Because on the other end of the scale, you are talking about autonomous driving, which is a bit of a controversial topic. And I'm not sure how is it even going to turn out in a country like Malaysia. That's a long story altogether. But I think the single biggest change, the two biggest change that the industry is probably going to see is how do brands differentiate themselves? Back then, when Chips started his business at the time, you can tell each brand had a very strong identity. You want driving pleasure, you go for Alfa Romeo. You want safety, you go for Volvo. You want prestige, you go for the Mercedes-Benz.
You want economy, you go for Watson.
But now everything is so muddled together. Even you talk about safety, it is one brand to another is really that big of a difference because of stricter regulations and all that. So, and now you talk about platform sharing now. You have an Audi that is sharing a platform with a VW, and never mind about that. We just saw the Mercedes X-Class. It was recently debuted in South Africa. It's underneath it is a Nissan Navara. And then if you go the next step even further, when you go into electric drive, we are all talking about plug-in hybrids, electric driving and all that. The role of the engine is becoming less and less. Electric drive simplifies the car a lot. You have a battery, you have an electric motor. So how different is one motor going to be from another? Motor characteristics are the same. So the differentiating, the areas that differentiate one car to another is becoming less and less. And you are sharing platform that limits how unique a car can be. And you are, and everybody is going to, infotainment is becoming very, very critical in a car now. We want connected apps, connected services and all that. Earlier on, we talked about the e-call and all. So all these things require standardization. And car companies cannot keep up with phones. How fast the product, a smartphone's product development cycle is what? 6 months? A car's development cycle is, model life cycle is easily 5 years. There's no way a car can keep up with a phone. So the next option, the next best option the car companies do is you have to have a system where you, instead of developing your own infotainment system, you have to just mirror it from a phone and you run. That means you have to run either on an Android or Android Auto platform or Apple CarPlay and things like that. Then it goes down even further. Your commonality between one car to another is getting very, very high. So how do you manage the identity of the brand? If you are at the supercar brand level, you are immune to this. I'm Porsche, I don't care about all these things. But if you are Toyota, if you are Honda, if you are Kia, how do you differentiate yourself anymore? And then going, if you look at back at how the industry has progressed in other countries, even young people in Europe, for example, they don't care about buying cars anymore. People just lease the car. I mean, you sign up a car sharing program. If you need a car, then you pay as you go.
Yeah, that's already happening. And then eventually, probably there will come one day that people don't own cars anymore.
Yeah. Right? So how is the car industry going to sustain? Going to adapt itself for the next 40 years? That's going to be very critical. Branding is going to be an increasingly critical part. Because I mentioned earlier, you can't focus, unless you are a supercar, super luxury brand, if you are a mass market brand, it's going to be very difficult for you to differentiate yourself anymore. Because the level of competition, the economics of the industry will force you to share common parts with other brands. And even if you don't share parts with other brands, you'll share parts with other different models, other models within your own range. When car companies talk about part platform sharing, part sharing, what they don't always mention is that that also means that you no longer have a tailor-made product. It's always a compromise.
If you want a tailor-made product, then you buy a Rolls Royce. You can have anything you want. But I think you left out that, okay, on the technical side, the cars are all going to become the same. So what will differentiate them is a human factor, and by human factor, I refer to how the customer is treated.
Going back to our earlier topic.
And that, if a customer is treated well, they'll probably stick with your brand. But if they have a bad experience, then they might be inclined to try another brand. And who knows, if the other brand treats them well, then you've lost a customer already.
What is the one feature in a car, right, that you guys think that should be standard for all the cars to come? Like not safety feature, I'm talking about like small little features that should come in all cars.
My friends in the industry will know that I will say teh tarik hook. Teh tarik hook. Why? Because our culture, we take away things a lot, tapau.
Tapau a lot, yes.
Teh tarik and fried kway teow and all. And I just feel that if we talk about what is in a Malaysian car, a teh tarik hook is what you need. And although a lot of people think I'm the one who originated this feature, actually, I would say it is a chap called Kucharan Singh.
He passed away. I wrote about him.
He passed away already, and he was the first general manager of Aeon. And I remember on the night that the Saga 1.5i was launched, we were at a club in Ampang for the launch. And he was saying, this Malaysian car should have this thing for, he called it a char kway teow hook. He said, when I buy my char kway teow, I want to hang my plastic bag somewhere. This is our Malaysian culture. Why don't they put such a feature in?
He's a Penang native, in case people don't know.
So, you know, I think that's the sort of thing that should be, and I've always pushed for it. My friends in Perodua and Proton, you know, the two Malaysian cars, the R&D people know if there's no teh tarik hook in the car, they will hear about it. I will talk about it, you know.
And nowadays they have, right?
A lot of cars have it. Yeah. It needs to be
designed. Yes, what I mean is...
It needs to be designed to be safe. So you cannot simply put it... That's the thing.
Talking about simply put it, our friend here, Wajen, who is operating the camera right now, he has an old Wira, and his dad sort of added a teh tarik hook. Was it a nail? Is it screw?
It's a metal rod. My father just bent it.
Yeah, so that's a mod. Yeah. So we Malaysians need that. We're gonna show that. We're gonna show that in the video. You see that that photo.
I feel the push button starting should be
keyless entry.
Keyless entry. You know, once you have keyless entry, you find that using a key to even press. At one time, remote control used to be the in thing, but now. You don't even want to take it out of your pocket. You walk to the door, you pull the handle, it opens, you know.
Once you have driven a car with keyless entry and all that, you won't get used to going back to using remote control anymore. Yeah, that's probably should be standard as well.
But keyless entry is an expensive feature at this time.
Still.
Yeah, because it's electronics and all, you know. It needs sensors and all that. So, it'll take a while, but you can get it even in a Vios now.
I would say seamless integration with my smartphone.
Doesn't that already exist?
It already exists, but it's not a seamless thing. You still have to go into your car, you plug in and all that. It's not something that I go in.
It's something that I don't bother to do, you know.
Yeah.
It's because it's so troublesome.
Yeah. I mean, we have the privilege of driving many different cars. So I've driven very high-tech cars with a lot of functions. But honestly, I don't even use an navigation system. Waze is just so much faster. I don't go through that dial and turn,
type out the whole address.
So if there is a very seamless, when I move into the car, it automatically syncs my phone and all that. That would be
a bit
awesome.
Like Bluetooth that automatically sync and sort of mirror whatever you're looking at. Let's say you're looking at Waze and
That also requires, I mean, then also it brings to, in order to achieve that, I suppose car companies to work with those phone companies, but they are already doing that now, I suppose. They are already doing that now, but they need to do it on a deeper level. Like right now, one feature which I wish all phones would have is you automatically turn on my Bluetooth the moment you know that I'm in a moving car. Because usually I manually turn off my Bluetooth and GPS. That's a conserved battery. Yeah. I mean, first world problem.
I think like you said, the technology in the phone is so much faster than a car. For them to create all this integration,
it's going to be difficult, correct?
It's difficult. I remember Bluetooth was evolving so rapidly, version 1, version 2, version 3, you know, that BMW, they told me, they said they had difficulty that some of the earlier cars, the Bluetooth was not compatible with the newer phones. Because when they finished integrating that version, Bluetooth had already moved to the next version, and of course the phone manufacturers will put in the latest one. So they always used to have that problem. I think today it's not so much of a problem. I think the industry has managed to find a solution.
Now I can think of something that I really need or want in a car. You know how nowadays phones are getting bigger and bigger?
Yeah.
Right? There's never a car, never a car that can actually fit this phone this big. Some call it the phablet.
A lot of Hondas can.
What's it? No. It's a new car, they can put a woman's handbag in.
CR-V.
You can put it into a girl's compartment and all that, but I need it
visible
while charging, while I'm looking at waist and all that, right?
Yeah.
Always it's put this way or some other way.
Yeah.
It's just never a compartment where it's large enough.
The problem is phone sizes are going big to small, small to big. When I first started buying phones, the aim was to make it as small as possible. So I had a phone about this size. Then they found that actually it's not practical.
Ericsson T28, I had that.
I had that. And then it started to become bigger, and then it become like yours. And maybe they'll go backwards again. So what do you want a car manufacturer to do? Which size should you take? Just like cup holders.
Yeah.
Which size do they take?
Yeah, actually talking about car holders as well, right? There are so many sizes right now, car holders in different cars. Some can't even hold a can of a drink properly.
The standard size that they take is a McDonald's cup. But then McDonald's cup also got, I think,
different
small,
sizes
medium,
in different countries.
Yeah, so it's very different. Okay, so you guys, what are the features that you guys want to have in cars? And also some experience like in the older days, your dad's car or your grandfather's car that you guys remember. Share below. Anything else, then probably Chips or Hans can also answer you guys.